Good evening.
Good evening.
You guys are making me feel a little lopsided with some over here, more over here than over here. So I'll just kind of stand over here and make you guys feel it. How about that? Welcome to our Thanksgiving evening worship services. It's a pleasure to welcome all of you here to Redeemer Lutheran Church. And maybe to fill you in on a couple of details before we get started tonight. We've had a little bit of a last minute panic moment because the cameras where we normally record the services aren't working up there. So we had to quick throw something together up front here, which the reason I pointed out to you is this evening we will be celebrating the Lord's Supper, which is really the best Thanksgiving meal that you're gonna get in the next couple of days. And as we do that, I've just got one elder helping me this evening. So the way that we will work this tonight is we'll do it like we do at the 11 o'clock service, which is we'll start with this whole section here, usher people forward as they come down this aisle. We will greet them here with the Lord's Supper, and then they can head back around the outside aisle. Then the elder and I will move to this portion right here. We'll also serve the folks here the same way. They'll come down the center. We will feed them the Lord's Supper here, and they can head back, and then we will move over. I'm telling you this because we're going to have to work around the camera just a little bit here. And I think it's got a wide enough angle lens that we can still capture the services this evening and get them posted to the web. But if we've become anything in the last several months with all of the stuff with COVID, we've become very flexible. Like that. Yeah. Yeah, not just flexible like that, but really flexible in how we operate. So I thank you for your willingness to work with us on this and to be patient with us as we try and accomplish delivering the word, delivering the good gifts of Thanksgiving, and welcoming people, even those who are unable to be with us here in church, to be a part of that same word with us. So welcome this evening as we prepare to give thanks. Hopefully you will recognize the service. It's divine service, the full divine service, since we will be celebrating the Lord's Supper this evening. But what you might also see is that these readings, and I'll point this out to you now, these are the readings that are appointed for a day of Thanksgiving each year. And so they're a reminder that the Lord's people in all places and all times, not only do we come together to receive the good gifts of God, but then we also don't fail to return thanks to our God either. So pay attention to that in the readings, because these are the very the standard readings that get used with this holiday service. I realize this is also a change for many of you, because as I was told beforehand, you're used to celebrating worship services on Thanksgiving Day. This was what I was used to, and I always found it to be more welcome by people because it freed them up on Thanksgiving Day to cook turkeys and pumpkin pies and things like that and welcome the guests and not have to break in the middle of all that. So I hope this is convenient for all of you, and maybe we'll see if we can try working this as we go forward. I think that's all of my announcements beforehand, so we begin with our opening hymn, number 892, Come, Ye Thankful People, Come.
Thank you.
Please rise for worship. We make our beginning this evening. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness. Therefore you are feared. Since we are gathered this evening to hear God's word and to call upon him in prayer, praise, and to receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and in deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake he forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our service continues with the words of this evening's introit. We speak these words responsively, whole verse by whole verse. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. O Lord, how manifest are your works! In wisdom have you made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. These all look to you to give them their food in due season. When you give it to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are filled with good things. When you send forth your spirit, they are created. And you renew the face of the ground. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. On high be glory and peace to all the earth. Goodwill from God in heaven proclaimed at Jesus' birth. We praise and bless you, Father, your holy name we sing. Our thanks for your great glory, Lord God, our heavenly King. Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, your mercies are new every morning, and you graciously provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may acknowledge your goodness, give thanks for your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the readings. Also at this time, I'm going to make a quick change. I know we had a reader probably selected for this evening, but because of our microphone issues and trying to get it recorded for the service, I'm going to go ahead and just take the readings over. I'm guessing it was you, Maggie. I'm sorry for usurping you and not mentioning this, but it didn't dawn on me until after I thought, I've got two microphones on and I better take this one for you. The Old Testament lesson for this evening comes from the book of Deuteronomy, the 8th chapter. The whole commandment that I command you today, you shall be careful to do, that you may live and multiply, and go in and possess the land that the Lord swore to give to your fathers. And you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. And he humbled you and let you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that a man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing did not wear out on you, and your foot did not swell these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, the Lord your God disciplines you. So you shall keep the commandments of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and by fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and springs, flowing out in the valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron and out of whose hills you can dig copper. And you shall eat and be full, and you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This evening's epistle lesson comes from the book of 1 Timothy, the 2nd chapter. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. This is good, and it is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand as we join together singing the Alleluia in verse. Hear now the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 17th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. When he saw them, he said to them, Go and show yourselves to the priests. And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice, and he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? And he said to him, Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We now have opportunity to confess our faith in the triune God using the words of the Nicene Creed. We confess. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God,
light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated as we sing hymn number 895, Now Thank We All Our God.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you all from God our Father and our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for this evening's sermon comes from the Old Testament lesson you heard read just a moment ago from Deuteronomy, the 8th chapter. Please be seated. Well, Thanksgiving 2020. It's sort of fitting, I guess, that the cameras went out on us before services tonight. It's 2020 after all. That the microphones, that I have to wear two different mics, one so that you can hear me out there, but another so that the camera can pick up, and so then I had to change up the service. You know, it just sort of figures. Doesn't seem like there's much to give thanks for, does there, in 2020? I mean, who honestly could count their blessings in a year when there have been so few of them, right? Well, I don't mean there hasn't been any blessings, but you know, the list of blessings would be a short one. The list of trials and troubles and things like that, I mean, we keep adding to it even in our worship service this evening. By the way, have you figured me out yet? I'm kind of a glass half empty guy. Yeah, I know, you're probably hoping for more of an optimist with your new pastor, but I guess the pessimist in me is trying to relate to you that the pessimist in me has probably enacted the pessimist in you. And I don't know, maybe it's just a temptation for us, A temptation to think that we don't really have that much to give thanks for, and that I'm not alone in this being a little bit pessimist, glass half empty kind of a guy. That in a year that's filled with trials and difficulties, from, you know, the list, I don't have to really rehearse it, do I? Coronavirus that's ruined for us whatever it was that maybe you wanted for yourselves. The calamity and discontent and difficulty with elections and social distance and separation and sickness and loneliness. And worst of all, you get stuck with a pessimistic prognosticator in the pulpit. But he can come up with a lot of P words. And these are just the obvious ones, the common ones that we all share together. We could all have some specific examples that we would add to such a list, wouldn't we? In my own world, there's been upheaval and change. Moving away from all that was familiar to a brand new community. And I'm not saying the community is bad. I'm just saying that sometimes, while it's nice to get a fresh new start, sometimes it's difficult. What box did we put that in? I'm still going through that, by the way. Kids, plural, kids away at different schools in different states at a time of pandemic. Trying to meet new people and they all look like this to me, and I don't even know what they look like, and I can't hear them and they can't hear me. New responsibilities. Change in general, I guess. And to be sure, I don't want to sound like I'm coming off like just a glass half-empty guy. I already warned you that's what I am, because not everything I've experienced has been terrible. There have been a lot of wonderful blessings that have come with this, and I give thanks for it even in the midst of all of this. But the truth is that as we enter this stretch of the year, from Thanksgiving to Christmas, I don't know about the rest of you, I start to reflect on some of this and reminisce, and maybe it's the holiday itself that forces me to do such. And the fact is, we really have quite a year to reflect on, don't we? With all that's happened. As much as I can lament some of the things that have happened, I am equally thankful for many things that have happened. Thankful for them, but at the same time wistful for some of the things that I haven't been able to take part in or that have changed. Am I alone? Am I the only one? I know that all of us in the room together here and those who are gathered with us even at distance have faced things that we've thought we'd never face this last year, even in these last days. We've been forced to change things, how we do things, even at last minute, with whom we do things. We've all made sacrifices, we've all suffered losses, and we've all faced change in our own ways, and it doesn't mean that there haven't been good things. It's only that the pessimists get a say in this, right? No, I'll let the optimists have their part too. There have been good amongst the bad. But which sticks in your minds more, the good or the bad? The bad. I've said this since graduating from seminary. The lines between good and bad have really gotten blurred for me. Blurred in the fact that things that the world would call good have tended for me in my faith life to work out poorly. Things that have been bad, that have captured my attention and captured my heart and captured my mind as I think about it, especially at this time of year, those are the things that for me seem to connect me even closer, to bring me to my knees, to call on my God, and to be reminded that even in those times of difficulty, I can give thanks to God in all circumstances. You know, the way it goes, it might be even said that we've had a taste of our own proverbial wilderness wandering. Couldn't we say that? Would that be overstating it? Maybe. Not many of us, if we call it a wilderness wandering, have ever had to sleep on the ground or in tents for these last 40 years. Maybe if we go camping for just a little while, but it's temporary, and then we get back to the roof over our head and the shower and the nice warm meals. Few of us, if any, have ever had to make sure that we were encamped near a stream, even though the place that we're now living is pretty close to the White River, so if I had to walk down there, I could. I don't worry about running water or having someone tapping on a rock with their staff to make sure that I can have a drink or flush the toilet in my house. Who among us has had to go outside of our homes and collect bread from the front yard just so that you could have something to eat that evening? Or had quail land in the backyard and you had to go get them and snap their little necks so that you could cook them over the fire outside? I just learned this last week. Yellville drops turkeys from planes? You could actually do this. It's not quail, it's turkeys of all things. They fall from the sky, just like WKRP in Cincinnati. God is my witness, I thought turkeys could fly. I'll never forget that line in WKRP in Cincinnati, but back on track. Maybe by comparison, our 2020 hasn't really been a wilderness wandering. So much it has been, well, trying. A trying year. Trying as in, we're trying to get through the rest of this year. We're trying to get to where we can get a vaccine distributed to everyone. We're trying to abide by all the regulations to not go out or not get together during holiday times so that we don't spread further this pandemic. Or maybe you're just trying not to listen to the whiny pastor up there in the pulpit. You get the picture. Even though we could say there's no direct correlation between the ancient Israelites and our situation today, I still think it would be fair to make some connections and observations. You see, just like the Israelites who were given to wander in the wilderness for 40 years on account of their sin, their rejection of God's commands, we too find ourselves today in the midst of sort of a struggle. Our struggles and our difficulties result from the fact that we were born in sin. And not just born in sin, but we are steeped in it. We bear in ourselves the image of our first parents, which was a sinful image after having lost the godly image that God created them in on account of their sin. And folks, we didn't just inherit their sin. We've done a pretty darn good job of creating our own sin ourselves, haven't we? Sinning daily and much in our thoughts, in our words, and in our deeds as we confess in church. We're easily reminded of our sinfulness, that we fall so short of God's good will that he has expressed to us in the Ten Commandments. Good old Wayne Meyer at my church that I served before this, in a Bible study one time, I asked, is God's will as expressed in the Ten Commandments all law? To which good old Wayne Meyer said, no, it's God's good will for us, that he wants us to live in accordance with the Ten Commandments. Not to look at them as though they're bad, like doing them is bad, but to look at them as though God gave us his very best. And yet we fall short of doing what God deems his very best. Just like our forefathers, who before Moses could even make it to the bottom of the hill, had crafted for themselves a golden calf. Indeed, we are like our forefathers. And our sins have driven us into our present wilderness. Time and again, the Israelites would defy and distrust and show disdain for God, but God would remain determined nonetheless in deigning to deliver, did you get all the D words? This undeserving lot, all that they need to support this body and life, as it says in our catechism. Even if it had to happen in the midst of a wilderness fraught with trial and tribulation, let us not forget that God, in the midst of their difficulty, still provided for them. Yahweh feeding them and leading them with water from the rock and manna from the sky and quails on their front lawns. God appointing leaders, watchmen in Moses and Aaron, acting as intercessors between a sinful humanity and a holy God. God does the same even today, doesn't he? Though his word and will are clearly communicated, easily taught, with the addition of bound volumes of Luther's small catechism that we can distribute to people where they can easily read the Ten Commandments right there at the beginning and learn God's will for their ways, we still quickly find other ways to live and to lead. And your wanderings in this wilderness of our world work to weigh you down. Your wish for, you long for, the land, the promised land, because you find that it's just not working. The troubles of this world bring to an end the glory of the Lord that should shine forth in your life and that God has in store that should begin for you. But yet we have to just look forward to them and await when God chooses to lead us there finally. Folks, if you can see these parallels from your own lives to the lives of your Israelite forefathers as I've described them, then you are properly prepared to procure of the prize that God has delivered. Today's Old Testament lesson from Deuteronomy 8, if you didn't know, is a sermon. It's a sermon preached by Moses and then written down. Literally, a sermon preached by God's servant Moses there on the banks of the Jordan River some 3,400 years ago. And in this sermon, God's servant, the intercessor between sinful people and holy God, Moses, preached those words that you heard read, words of both law and gospel. God's people on the brink of entering the land that God had promised to them after bringing them out of slavery in Egypt and yet still leading them through that wilderness for 40 years, all the while God was still in the midst of them. In a pillar of cloud by day, a pillar of fire by night, providing for their every need. Manna, quail, water, God was providing. And here and now, in this reading from Deuteronomy 8, this sermon preached so long ago that gets read and reread annually, here some 3,400 years later, we find that some things never change. We still struggle and strain and complain. We still wander. And on this all account of our sins, God still in the midst of it remains just and holy and caring and loving. He leads you and guides you and provides for you. Maybe not by causing flocks of quail to land within arm's reach to eat or by creating streams of flowing water out of the ground. All the ground around here is rock, so I guess it could come from just about anywhere, or even by dropping bread into your front yard. But God has sent me, at least, lucky you, his servant and pastor, to remind you of his gifts and mercy. Through me as his intercessor now, through the words that I preach to you that echo those words preached so long ago, even though they come from a pessimist, to remind you of God's law, but to uplift you with God's gospel, we have a reason to give thanks, because God's law is good. And the gospel, the saving gospel that comes to us in the person and work of Jesus Christ, who leads us first and foremost as the firstborn of the dead into the promised land, giving us hope of salvation. Well, folks, the wilderness and its wanderings will come to an end, and we can indeed give God thanks for both his law and his gospel. It's my work to divide both for you. A law that condemns you, the pessimist side of me, curbing your bad behavior, serving as a mirror to show you your sin, guiding you in the ways that God would have you go, but also God's gospel. It's my joy to proclaim it to you. They're both good gifts from God. The gospel loves, forgives, and leads you, guides you, and instills faith in you, and the combination of both in being in the hearing of both reminds you that this wilderness that we find ourselves in today will ultimately bring us to the river's edge. The river's edge that leads us then into that promised land. A very real land for the Israelites so long ago, and a very real land for us that God still has in store.
Listen again how Moses preached from the banks of the Jordan River. Know in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, the Lord your God disciplines you. Hence our wilderness wandering. So you shall keep the commandments of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and fearing him, for the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and springs, flowing out in the valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron and out of whose hills you can dig copper. You know what? It's the same sermon from me. God has the land in store for you. Raised from the dead, all who believe in Christ Jesus have a similar land in store for them. A land where, as King David says, we, his sheep, get to lay down in lush green pastures by streams of quiet water and to be provided for as we have always been. The trials, the tribulations, and the wilderness of this world, a far distant memory. Don't be dismayed because his timing is not our timing. Instead, look to the promise and thank him all along the way, because the promise has been made good and sealed in his son, Jesus Christ. The Lord God did it for his people Israel, and he will do it for you. And this, as Luther says in the Catechism, for all this, it is my duty to give thanks and praise, serve and obey him. This is most certainly true. Amen. And now may God's peace, may it be granted to you. May the foresight of the land that he has in store for you be at the forefront of your minds. And may we all collectively give thanks to him for all the good gifts that he has given. Amen. We now hear our special music.
Thank you.
Please stand for the prayers of the church. Friends in Christ, we all lift up our hearts to God and pray together to Christ our Lord, as He has taught us and freely promised to hear us. God, our Father in heaven, look with mercy upon us, Your needy children on earth, and grant us grace that Your holy name be hallowed by us and all the world through the pure, true teaching of Your word and the fervent love shown forth in our lives. Graciously turn from us all false doctrine and evil living, whereby Your precious name is blasphemed and profaned. Lord, in Your mercy,
prayer.
May Your kingdom come to us and expand, O Lord. Bring all transgressors and those who are blinded and bound in the devil's kingdom to know Jesus Christ, Your Son, by faith, that the number of Christians would be increased. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Strengthen us by Your Spirit according to Your will, both in life and in death. In the midst of both good and evil things, that our own wills would be crucified daily and sacrificed to Your good and gracious will. In Your hands, O Lord, we commend all those for whom we pray that are in need, praying for them at all times, Thy will be done. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant us our daily bread, O Lord. Preserve us from greed and selfish cares. Help us to trust in You to provide for all of our needs. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Forgive us our sins, as we also forgive those who sin against us, so that our hearts would be at peace and would rejoice with a good conscience before You, and that no sin would ever frighten or alarm us. Lord, in Your mercy, lead us not into temptation, O Lord, but help us by Your Spirit to subdue our flesh, to turn from the world and its ways, and to overcome the devil with all his wiles. Lord, in Your mercy. Lastly, O Heavenly Father, deliver us from all evil of both body and soul, now and forever. Lord, in Your mercy, we trust, O Lord, in Your great mercy to hear and answer us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue with the service of the sacrament. I apologize, but now my microphone that you hear me with has stopped working. So I'll try and make it as loud as we can, and we will remember that it's 2020, and we still have reasons to give thanks to God, right? The Lord be with you,
and also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to You, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings You so freely bestow on us and on all creation. Above all, we give thanks for Your boundless love shown to us when You sent Your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh, and You laid on Him our sin, giving Him into death that we might not die eternally. Because He has now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in Him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify Your glorious name, evermore praising You and saying, blessed are You, O Lord, our God, King of all creation, for You have had mercy on us and given Your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but would have eternal life. In Your righteous judgment, You condemned the sin of Adam and Eve, who ate the forbidden fruit, and You justly barred them and all their creation from the tree of life. Yet in Your great mercy, You promised salvation by a second Adam, Your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and You made His cross a life-giving tree for all who trust in Him. We give You thanks for the redemption You have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. We pray that You would grant us Your Holy Spirit so that we would faithfully eat and drink the fruits of His cross and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in His body and blood. Hear us as we pray in His name and as He has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Welcome to the Lord's table. Take and eat the body of Christ, given into death for you. Take and drink the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for the forgiveness of your sins. And now may this true body and blood of our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace, enjoy, your sins are forgiven. Amen. I can take it now.
Okay.
They're still singing.
Welcome to the Lord's table. Take and eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who died for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who died for the forgiveness of your sins. Cover these now.
I'll just say this special real quick. Now may this true body and blood of our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace and joy. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Please stand as we join together and sing the Nunc Dimittis.
Now let your soul depart.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be
to God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated as we sing our closing hymn, Give Thanks.